Bismillahirrahmanirrahim, dear students. Today's lecture is actually related to different strategic choices. As we have already discussed about mergers, acquisition, but there are certain other alternative to these merger and acquisitions. When we talk about mergers and acquisition, so basically it's a growth strategy in which company want to extend their operations. So they'll go for different type of merger and acquisition activities, whether in their own line of business or whether their different type of businesses or whether their companies which are related to their value chain. But apart from that there are certain other strategic choices which can also lead to extension of their businesses. So this lecture is actually related to all those alliances, and not only that, we'll also have an overview to these merger and acquisition activities on the perspective of the entrepreneur or the businessman, that how these all these type of business extension strategy will help them to achieve their ultimate goal of extending their business and increasing their business operations, whether within their own country or globally. So moving on to different type of choices, we'll be discussing all these things in the next few slides. Like when we are talking about a strategy method or strategic options, so mainly all these type of activities, merger and acquisition and strategic alliances, are there for the extension of your business operations. So you can opt for diversification. As diversification, as you know that there are different type of diversification, whether you'll go and have businesses or acquire industry businesses of your own line of business or different type of businesses. So there are different type of diversification, with whether they are concentric, in which you will opt for retaining or remain into your own line of business, and you'll go for buying different type of businesses which are actually related to your own business operations, or you'll go for acquiring your suppliers, or you'll be you can become your own seller or wholesaler or distributor, or you can go for conglomerate diversification, in which you will go for different line of business. You will opt for having different line of businesses, or you can go, opt for internationalization. Like you want to extend your operation globally, you want to show your international presence, so you'll go for that. Or you will go for innovation, like in which you want to create something new for the world. So all these things are there, but whether you or go for diversification, internationalization, or innovation, you need resources, and most of the time you don't have much type of resources. Like you must have financial resources, but you need different other type of resources, like your like physical resources, like many other type of managerial resources and physical resources. So when you are opting for all these things, you can do it in majorly three type of options. Like you can go for organic development. Organic development is actually related to developing your own resources, creating your own value, and putting your own financial resources in order to develop your organization. Then the second option would be the merger and acquisition. Like you can acquire different type of business, or you can go and merge with different type of businesses, or in their own line of businesses, or many other type of businesses, or you can acquire them, you can merge with them. Or the third option is different type of strategic alliances. So these our main focus of this lecture is actually strategic alliances. Like there are different type of strategic alliances. If I name a few, there could be a joint venture, there could be a build operator, net transfer options, greenfield development, and there are different other type of strategic alliances in which you can increase your operation. Or and mostly these strategic alliances are used in internationalization, in which you want to show your international presence. But but you can also have strategic alliances for innovation and diversification. Now, first option would be your organic development. Actually, organic growth or organic development actually refers to the growth of business through internal processes, and it actually relies on its own resources, whether whatever resources you have, whatever your capabilities are, it depends upon your own internal strength. Like if you have assets, so you can go and have finances and have mortgage on those assets, or you can go for IPOs, or you can also issue bonds and many other type of financial instruments in order to generate funds for your internal development. So there are different strategies for organic growth. It could be optimization of processes, reallocation of resources, and new product offering. It will help you to boost your sales. It will help you to decrease your cost of production. And whenever you want to compare your organic growth or organic development, it can be done by comparing your sales or revenues of different year or year after year, and different other sales which are being done to different stores. This organic growth is in contrast to inorganic growth. As when we talk about external growth, it includes growing your business operation through different type of strategic alliances or different other type of merger and acquisition activities. So this option is open for the businesses that they'll go for using their own resources for the development of their organization. So this is called as organic development, or you can say that it's do-it-yourself method. Now, as we are discussing organic development or development by the organization himself, and this kind of strategy in which the company is not opting for any kind of merger and acquisition activity or strategic alliances. When the company goes for its own organic growth, it loses many benefit associated with other kind of strategic options. But obviously, organic development has its own advantages. Like obviously, when you are doing all the thing yourself, you are arranging finances, you are developing your resources, you are working for innovation, you are working for diversification, and obviously you are working for internationalization. So all the procedures and all the things will be done by yourself and your organization. So it will also obviously increase or enhance the knowledge and learning of the people who are working within your organization. Then spreading investment over time, like it's easy for you to finance the different type of activities because you are in continuous process of generating funds for your different type of business options. It's easier to finance different type of activities when you are working as a corporation business. You'll go for bank loan, or you'll go for issuing bonds or stocks or preferred stocks. Or you can also generate other type of fund, or you can increase your sale in order to have more profit and retain more amount of profit in order to finance different activity. So as the third option is that as you are your own boss, you are all doing all your activities yourself, so you cannot face any type of constraints, and there's no need for searching for partners or acquisition targets because you are not opting for that options. So unnecessary investigation activities and evaluation activities and different type of other activities is not needed in that case. Then you are strategically independent. You don't have to see your other partners, or you don't have to see other people who are working with you in order to have a compromise or accept any type of strategic constraints, because you are working independently. You are not working with any any other type of partners. So in that case, it's also beneficial to have organic growth, because it will give you strategic independence in the case of this kind of activity. So there are the other option might be your merger and acquisition. As we have already discussed different details regarding merger and acquisition and many other type of valuation methods and different type of motives regarding your merger and acquisition, it's generally an overview of all those things. Like when we talk about merger, so it is actually the combination of two companies who were working separately in the previous periods, and they want to have a combined operations. It might be possible that one parties have a little larger equity than the other firm, but mostly they are 50-50 partners. But in case of an acquisition, in this type of activity or in this type of strategic alliance, the one company has a higher ownership as compared to the other company, and mostly these acquisition are called as a takeover. And there are certain type of hostile takeovers in which there are different methods in which the companies go and take over the firm, and that actually called as hostile takeovers. But whatever you will do, whether you will go for merger or whether you will go for acquisition, there are certain strategic motives regarding these merger and acquisition activity, and we have already discussed all these things in the previous lectures. But I just want to give you a main three motives which can be an pursual, or we can be a motivational factor regarding this kind of activity. One would be the extension. Like, you want to increase the operations of your business, you want to increase geographically, or you want to increase your operating markets, or you want to increase your economies of scale, or you want to increase your efficiency, or you want to increase your market power, because you want to you don't want to have more competitors in your market, so you'll acquire those competitors in order to decrease the competition in the market. Or in certain cases, when you don't have certain technology or capabilities, and the other firm might have these kind of technologies, so you'll go and acquire those firm in order to have this technology or access to that competency. If you look into the merger of Warid and Jazz, so that is an example of this increasing capabilities. And like Warid has 4G license, and Jazz has the larger extended network of different towers. So the merger of those businesses have benefit, and the companies have Jazz has increased its capabilities by acquiring Warid, because Jazz has a larger interest in Warid. This Warid and Jazz merger. As we are discussing different motives of merger acquisition, and obviously we have discussed different type of motives of merger and acquisition in previous chapters. Like first of all is your financial efficiency. Like a company which has a very strong balance sheet or who's very rich in cash can acquire or merge with company with a weak balance the balance sheet, like which has a high debt, because this kind of thing will be helpful, because there are many good investment opportunities which are being missed by the companies who are in short of cash, and they are not in a position to increase their cash. So in this to generate cash in order to acquire those investment. But if you will merge with that kind of company, you will be in a position to invest in those projects and use your excess cash in those beneficial or profitable opportunities. Obviously, when the company has high debt, they are they have they can save their the profits, or they can have tax benefit. So obviously you can get the tax benefit with that, because there are the firms which has which is not doing profitably in the previous periods, and whose profits are consistently low, so they are in the negative tax brackets. So you can avail those negative taxes to decrease your own tax burden. Third thing is assets stripping or unbundling. When you are acquiring other firms, so it will help you to acquire different type of asset, which will be helpful for you to do on your own activities. But in other case, you have certain assets which need certain type of stripping, or you want to get rid of those assets, or you want to have different type of asset combinations. So it will helpful for you to have different combination of assets, and in this case you can maximize the values of your asset. There are many managerial motives for merger and acquisition, as if you see that not only financial and strategic motives are there for merger and acquisition, as managers are there and they want to serve their self-interest, and basically for two reasons. First one is personal ambitions, financial incentives are actually tied to short-term growth or share price targets, so that will boosting this will boost personal reputation, and they will give friends and colleagues greater responsibility or better jobs. So in this case, they'll pursue different merger and acquisition activity in order to entertain all these the people from which they want to get benefit, or if they want to give them benefit based upon their position. Secondly, another aspect or another important managerial motive is bandwagon effects. In certain cases, when managers do not go for merger and acquisition activity, or they are not pursuing a growth strategy or the different other extension strategies, so they will actually the shareholder will pressurize them to go or merge or acquire certain firms, because if they don't do that, the company may itself become a takeover target. So in certain times they are actually forced to follow a merger and acquisition trend. Emphasis or the main thing is target choice in merger and acquisition. When you are selecting, or any company is selecting their merger and acquisition targets, they'll basically take two criteria. One is strategic fit, you are pursuing your own strategy, the other company is pursuing their own strategy, so you have to see that does the target firm strengthen or complement the acquiring firm strategy. And but there are certain time that you can overestimate the potential synergy. Secondly, the organizational fit. Is there a match between the management practices, cultural practices, and staff characteristic of the target and the acquiring firm? Because when you are combining both firms, or you are combining those both businesses, the major problem you will face are the disparity of cultures or characteristic of the different staff members, and the transition or integration would be very difficult when all these things are not compatible. So when you are selecting a target firm for merger and acquisition activity, it's very important that you see that whether there is a strategic fit and organization fit between both organizations who are actually planning for merger and acquisition. Now, integration in merger and acquisition. In the following figure, you can see that there are two criteria resulting in five integration approaches, and these approaches have important implication for the length of integration period and the choice of the top management for the acquired firm. The first strategy, or the first option, is absorption. which is actually preferred or being used where there is a high level of strategic interdependence, which is necessary, and there is little need for organizational autonomy. Absorption requires a rapid adjustment of acquired companies or strategies and structures to the need of the new owner and corresponding changes to the acquired company's culture and system. In this type of acquisition, it is usual to appoint a new top manager in order to manage the organization differently. The second approach is preservation, which is appropriate where the acquired company is well run but not very compatible with the acquirer. So the high need for autonomy and low need for integration may be found in conglomerate deals, like as a conglomerate is actually a combination of different businesses which are indulged in business activity of unrelated businesses. So the preservation style depends on allowing old strategy, culture and system to continue in the acquired company much as before. Changes from the acquirer are generally confined to the essential minimum, such as financial reporting procedure for control, and carried out in slow piecemeal fashion. In this situation, it is advisable to retain the incumbent management. You don't have to change the manager. So the third approach is symbiosis, which is indicated where there is strong need for strategic interdependence but also a requirement for a high autonomy. As in a professional service organization, dependent on the creativity of its staff, symbiosis implies that both acquired firm and acquiring firm learn the best qualities for the other. This learning process obviously takes significant amount of time, and it is often is the case that it is best to retain the incumbent top management in the early stage to stabilize the acquisition before bringing a new top manager to make far-reaching changes. This is the most complex of the integration approach. The fourth option is approaches intensive care, which takes place where there is little to be gained by integration. Like this in acquisition may occur when the acquired company is in poor financial health, and very rapidly rapid remedial action is required. So the acquirer will also not integrate the company into its own business, and to avoid contamination, but will impose stringent short-term targets and strategies in order to solve its problem. In more aggressive turnout cases, the incumbent top management will typically be replaced, but otherwise he is retained for a smoother transition. These businesses may often be for sale. The fifth option is reorientation. Like acquisition occur when the acquired company is in good health and well run, but there is a little to integrate central administrative areas and align marketing and sales function. Distinctive resources of the acquired company though are left alone, and there are few changes to the internal operation. In order to drive through changes quickly, a new top manager is generally appointed or brought it into run the acquired company. So these different type of integration approaches are used in order to make the merger and acquisition successful after the collaboration or after the merger and acquisition activity. Now the third option or the third strategic option is strategic alliances. And what is strategic alliance? Actually, a strategic alliance is where when you have two or more organization and they share their resources, and also they want to participate in different type of activities collaboratively or collectively to pursue certain type of strategies. So they'll pursue a collective strategy, and it is about the whole network of alliances of which an organization is a member. They compete against rival network of alliances. And the main advantage is actually collaborative advantage, because these alliances are managed in a better way against their competitor, and also if they are working against each other. So as compared to working as a rival, they'll be doing better as when they are doing all these activity collaboratively. And these strategic alliances are a mutual done for a mutually beneficial projects, in which each retain its independence. The agreement is less complex and less binding than a joint venture, in which two companies pool resources to create a separate business entity. A company may enter into strategic alliance in order to increase their market presence. They want to improve their product line, and also they want to develop an edge over competitors. So the arrangement allows two businesses or businesses to work together or toward a common goal that will provide benefit to both parties. These relationship or these arrangement may be for a shorter time period or for a longer time period, and they might be formal or informal. Whatever the case is, the main crux or the main the task or the main essence of this type of strategic alliances are that they want to work together, and they don't want to compete with each other, but they want to work collaboratively in order to benefit from their collaboration. Because whenever you are competing each other, what you will doing is you will damaging the reputation of each other, or you will be rivaling or compromising on your profits by decreasing prices and many other kind of things, or expending too much money on your advertising and different type of other type of techniques. So in order to spend too much money on those activities, what you will do is you will collaborate with your competitors and work in collaboration with them in order to have a benefit and benefit with of coordination and integration. And obviously, if you are working together, what you the market will also get a better quality of product rather than a product which is of low quality and on lower prices. So this would be benefit for both for the on the consumer point of view and for the employer or for the manufacturer point of view. Now, while talking about strategic alliances, there are two main kinds of ownership in strategic alliances. First one is equity alliances. What is equity alliances? As when it involves the creation of new equity that is owned separately by the partners involved. Both partners share that equity, and they share which were previously owned separately by both partner, and when they combine and share those equities and create a new equity, that is called as equity alliances. But in case of there is another form in strategic alliance, that is non-equity alliances, and that actually are typically looser without the commitment implied by the ownership. Like there is no ownership or equity participation, but there is a certain kind of commitment which is implied by ownership. Talk about equity alliances. So the most common form of equity alliance is a joint venture, and in this kind of alliance there are two organizations which remain independent, and they don't lose their independency, but they're there, but they have they want to set up a new organization which is jointly owned by the partners. Like in this case, both companies have combined their resources in order to in order for a certain project or attainment of certain projects. So that is called as a joint venture. In this case, the independence of both the parties are not compromised. They'll retain their independence, but they have joined together in certain types of project or business. Another form of mutual equity alliance is consortium, and a consortium alliance actually involves there are certain partners. In this case, when there is a certain project and it needs certain type of resources which cannot be acquired or which cannot be generated by two firms, so more than two firms come and they'll join a venture. So they set up a venture in order to complete a project, in order to do a business, and that is called as consortium alliance. Whatever the case is, the main emphasis is that there is a collaboration of efforts. They combine different businesses combined together in order to have certain benefit in their benefit in the gain certain benefit from the market. So this is called as equity alliance. Now, other type of alliance, strategic alliance, is a non-equity alliance, and these type of alliances are mainly based on contracts. And three form of non-equity alliance are there. First of all, there is a franchising. And what is franchising? Is franchising actually is a strategic alliance between groups of people or different businesses who have specific relationship and responsibilities with common goal to dominate market. That is to get and keep more customer than their competitors. Like if you can give a franchise to certain businesses in different geographical areas, and they'll perform all the activities. But the main emphasis of crux of franchising is that you have to have to pursue the marketing strategies and activities just like the real owner. Obviously, in franchises, the person who get the franchise has to share their portion of their sales as well with the franchisor. So this is the other type of non-equity strategic alliance is licensing. As the name suggests, that the parent company or the company who is actually doing the operations, they'll grant permission to certain other businesses to perform those activities, because this is a permission which is being granted by a competent authority, and which is given to exercise a certain privilege that without such authorization would constitute an illegal act. So these certificate or the document itself that confirms permission to engage in otherwise prohibited proscribed conduct. So a license is different for permit. The term license and permit are often used interchangeably, but generally a permit describe more temporary form of permission. For example, if a homeowner seeks to make structural addition to a property, she may have to apply for permits from local land use. These permits expire on certain date or when the work is finished. But in case of contract, who completes the work will likely to hold a local license that allows her to operate her business for a certain number of periods. So these licenses are important and unambiguous features of contemporary society. So your different type of governments rely on licenses to control a broad range of human activity, from commercial and professional to dangerous environmental issues. So licenses may be actually issued private parties and by patent or copyright holder as well. So these licenses are like, we can also see the licensing arrangement between Pepsi Cola and many other type of businesses. So they have grant permission to different manufacturers of different countries in order to provide or distribute their products. So and that is actually legal as well. On the other hand, we have a third type of non-equity strategic alliance that is called as long-term subcontracting. So this long-term subcontracting, actually it is related to the practice of bringing an outside company or individual to perform specific parts of a contract or a project. In most cases, a company subcontracts another business to perform a task that cannot be handled internally. That is called as outsourcing as well. In the construction business, a general contractor typically organizes certain subcontractors that specialize in different type of activities or specific trades. So they are three type of non-equity strategic alliances. In this type of alliances, equity is not involved, but there is a commitment between different parties in order to give mutual benefit to both parties, or when how much the parties are involved in these alliances. So there are certain motives for these kind of strategic alliances. First of all is scale alliances. Scale alliances, actually it is related to your operations, or you want to enhance your scale of production, or many other type of skills. Like first of all, you can lower your cost by combining your production. So obviously it will lower your cost, lower cost of both the parties or different parties who are involved, and they'll achieve economies of scale, which will increase the portion of their profit. Secondly, they have a more bargaining power. Like as you are against your supplier or against your customer, because previously you are operating separately, now you are operating collaboratively, your competition has decreased. In this case, you can bargain for lower prices with your suppliers, and you can bargain for higher prices with your customer. So this is actually will give you more power in the market. Secondly, you can also share your risk, which will diversify risk and decrease a certain type of risk, because you will share different type of risk equally. Then excess alliances is that partner provides needed capabilities. Like there are certain companies who have more distribution channels, there are certain companies who have more technologies, companies who have different type of licenses and different type of access to different technologies. So when you collaborate with each other, you have access to all these type of capabilities and competencies. Thirdly, you have complementary alliances. Like there are certain strengths in one company, and there are certain other type of strength in other company. Like you have one company have physical resources which are very much productive and which can be a competitive advantage for that company. On the other hand, the other company have manpower who have more capabilities, who have more managerial skills, and certain other type of capabilities. So both these strengths will complement in each other, and they will help to overcome the weaknesses of each other. Then the last thing is collusion alliances. Obviously, just like scale alliances, when you collaborate with each other, you have more power in the market, because previously you were competing with each other, and they will try to destroy each other's market, you try to snatch the market shares of each other. But now you are working collaboratively within the market, so obviously you will be complementing each other, and it will help to increase your market power. And now you are competing with your other competitors more properly, and you have more power in the market. Then obviously it's usually kept a secret to evade competition regulations. So this will all these things were very important for your strategic alliances, and these are actually motives and motivational factor for different type of strategic alliances. Now, these motive which we have discussed in the previous slides are properly depicted or being shown with this diagram. If we look into the first diagram, which shows scale alliances, now you are actually getting different type of inputs from the outside world, and with the help of these inputs, what you will do is you will have you are collaborating with each other and giving outputs to the market. So obviously this collaboration will help to reduce your cost by achieving your economies of scale and access to the market, and obviously decreasing your and increasing your market power or market share. Secondly, you have excess alliance. Like if you don't have access to certain markets, like in India, there are certain Sri Lankan companies have cannot enter into that market. So what they'll do is they'll make a strategic alliance with Indian companies and get access into the Indian market. So obviously this is called as your excess alliance, and there are many other type of excess alliances as well. Then you have collusion alliance. A collusion alliance is that you combine your resources, and but you are working separately, but actually what you are doing is you are collaboratively targeting market and getting a different type of benefit of these strategic alliance. Then a complementary alliance, as we have discussed, that different partners have different type of resources, whether it would be physical, whether it is your human resources. So when one company is weak in one type of resource, so other company will help them in that type of resources, and so on with vice versa. So with complementary alliances, you will be able to produce good products, and your output in the market would be better, and the market would be served with better products. Not only that, that these complementary alliances will help you to benefit from your market, benefit from these type of scales, and in help to generate more revenues and generate more profit from the market. So with the help of these diagrams, you can clearly understand that the strategic alliances would be helpful in growth strategies, and the, and with collaborative effort, the companies will be in a position to retain better position in the market. Now, strategic alliances process. That how the process of strategic alliance start, and what are the necessary prerequisites for strategic alliances. So there are two themes which are very vital to success in alliances. One is a co-evaluation, and the second one is trust. Co-evaluation, it's very important that when the companies or when the different type of businesses come up together, there should be a flexibility in both type of organization, because when two companies work together, like previously they were competing or they were not working together, so there are certain disparities between the environment of both the companies. So it's very important that there should be flexibility and change as the environment competition and strategies of the partners involved. Like previously you were pursuing different type of competitive strategy, you were differently dealing with the environment, but now when you are making alliance with your competitor, so you have to make different type of strategies, whereas previously you were rivals, but now you are partners. So in this case, you have to evolve your strategy like the strategic partners, and obviously when you are more flexible to change, when you are more prone to accept these things, that now the environment is changed, so there would be better chances that this strategic will align for a longer time period. Second one is your trust. Like any type of relationship, whether it is your personal relationship, whether you or it's a business relationship, trust is the main you can say the foundation stone of any type of relationship. So partners need to behave in a trustworthy fashion. throughout the alliance, because you are actually have made a collaboration or alliance for the mutual benefit. So it's very important that you should trust each other, and not only that, you have to be very trustworthy with each other. When there is when there is a problem with that, obviously that alliance will not last for a longer term period. So there, these two things are vital for a success of strategic alliance. One is that when you are collaborating with each other, there should be flexibility in your strategy, and you have to develop, or you have to mold your strategy, you have to mold yourself according to the environment, because now the human resource, the physical resources are being shared. So you have to make the strategies just like that in order to create change in the environment, because now those competitors who had pursued different competitive strategies with you and who have damaged you in the previous period, now you have to make collaboration with that. So in that case, you need flexibility over that, and obviously change in the environment, because the different people have come up with you, and there are different, you have to share different secrets with your partner. So all this thing has to be done in a very more flexible way. Secondly, trust is also very important, because you are making long term relationship. For that, the trust should be there. So if these two things are there, there are more chances that these strategic alliance will last for a longer time period. Now we will discuss alliance evolution, because when the companies want to make alliance with each other, it's very important that this process should be done carefully, and there is a certain evaluation procedure which start with the courtship. Like courtship means that there is a little bit collaboration between partners, mostly in managerial activities or in many other aspects. So in that time, when they think that you can better understand each other, you can work together, and the employees of the companies have a potential to work together, so they'll go for negotiation. Like they negotiate with each other and find out the similarities, and find out the similar strategic or similar vision for the future, in order to do pursue different type of projects in the future collaboratively. Once your negotiation successful, you'll go for a startup phase, in which you start committing resources and start working together. And in this next time period, which is a little larger time, which has a little larger time span, in which the activities start emerging, and you'll the partners work with each other, and they'll start taking projects with each other, and work together, and if they think that this partnership is better off, so they'll take more projects in the future. But once this stage is there are certain time when of alliance will have to have an agreed time span, or it is for specific purpose from the very start. So termination is obviously a matter of completion rather than failure. Here separation is amicable. Like when you are separating, it's not forceful, or it's not something that you don't want to work together in the future, but it's like that you have come up with a certain project at very start. You have decided that you will complete that project and you'll separate your paths. But sometimes the alliance has been so successful that the partner will wish to extend it by agreeing a new alliance between themselves and commit more resources rather than separating with each other. Sometimes too, the alliance will have more of a success for one party rather than the other party, with one party wishing to buy the other share in order to commit fully, while the other party decide to sell out. So the sale of one party's interest need not to be sign of failure, as their strategic agenda may have changed since alliance formation. However, sometimes it can end in a bitter divorce, there are certain conflicts between parties, and or certain bad intentions had happened due to which there are lawsuit or counter lawsuit. So in this case there is a termination, but this termination is not a very pleasant one. So in this case your termination need to be carefully managed, because when you co-evaluate, there are mutual trust is likely to be valuable after the completion of any particular partnership. Like partners sometimes are engaged in many other type of joint projects at a different geographical distribution, or at the same time they are working in different projects. Like you can take the example of Cisco and IBM, as they are partner in different multiple simultaneous projects of wireless communication industry, IT security, and data centers and data storage. So the partners may need to come together again for new project in future. So like Nokia and Ericsson and Siemens have had mobile telephone technology, and they have a joint projects in 1990s. So maintaining mutual trust in termination stage is very important if the partner are to co-evolve through generation of multiple projects. So in this case we can say that the termination stage should be carefully handled if you want to pursue certain other projects in the future. Now, in order to compare acquisition, alliances, and organic development, we'll see all the three concepts or all the three strategic options based upon different concepts, like high agency actually means that whether the growth or whether the development in the organization would be accelerated, or high uncertainty, like risk. In case of risk, what would be the benefit or obstacle in these options? Soft capabilities, importance, and high modular capabilities. So high modular capabilities means that how you can incorporate new ideas and make change or make alteration in different type of business activities. So based upon all these things, we'll see that how a strategic option would be helpful in increasing your growth, or uncertainty, how the uncertainty would be handled, how there is would be an impact there, the soft capabilities, and also if you want to change or make alteration in different kind of activities, so what would be option would be better. So first of all, we'll see high agency. High agency means that there would be increased growth, your urgent growth, in when it's when you will go for buy or ally option. Like when you want to accelerate your growth, when you want to make expansion in your business, so in that case better to go for buy or ally option, because in case of organic growth, it's a very slow process. In case of a buy or ally option, you will be purchasing the capabilities of other people, or you will going and making alliances with those people. So it will rather than creating your own the capability, you will be you are sharing or you are acquiring the capabilities of other. So it will accelerate your growth, and you will be in a better position for developing your capabilities more rapidly as compared to organic growth. Because when you will go for your organic growth, so all things you have to do, you have to do it yourself. You have to arrange for your finances, you have to arrange, or you have to make proper decisions. Whatever you want to do is you have to do it yourself. So in that case, the urgency will be slow, and there will be a slow growth in your activity. But in case of uncertainty, like risk factor, so in the risk factor, in the case of buy and ally option, it's better to go for ally and buy option when there is high uncertainty in the market. Because whenever you see failure in certain businesses or certain dimension, so you can sell that thing, and also when you are aligning with that, so you can keep those units or those businesses which you think would be better. You'll retain those things, and you'll get rid of those businesses which you think that they will have a high certainty and they will not give you benefit. But in case of do it yourself or in organic growth, you have problem because all the risk has to be faced by the business and it cannot be sellable. The third thing, that is soft capability, is important. So this kind of thing is actually more beneficial in do-it-yourself business, but as compared to that, your in buy or ally option, because different business cultures and different businesses are combining with each other, and those businesses were previous period were competing in the market. So in that case, there are problem because you had the conversion of their behavior. The transition and all these things will have to take a certain amount of time. So you have a cultural and valuation problem when you'll go for buy option, because obviously you'll go and see the valuation. Obviously you buy those companies which you think that are undervalued, or they'll give you benefit when you change the control, or so on, many other motives. So in that case, if you are mistaken in valuing that thing, so it create a problem for you. And so same is the problem with ally option, because you have certain things in mind that we can ally with these firms because you want to have control on certain things. But if that thing will not be translated, so it can create problem. But in case of do-it-yourself option, you have cultural consistency, because there is no change of culture. All the people are working, you are consistently, and they are working, and they are working for the expansion and growth of the business. So there is no problem with cultural transition of type of thing. Then high modular capabilities, because when you are making a change or when you are making transition, so you have a problem of buying the whole company, because you cannot buy the whole company. You can take those parts which are many beneficial for them. So on the other hand, when you allying something, so you can only ally with those units of the certain company which you think is better for you. But in case of do it yourself, you have to create a new whole department for a new whole venture, because you are changing the line of business, or you are making alteration in the kind of business you are doing. So in that case, you have to develop a new venture in do it yourself option. There are different key success factors when you enter into merger and acquisition or strategic alliances. First of all, when you are merging or when you are making alliances with similar kind of businesses, first thing you have to see that there should be a strategic fit. Like, a strategic fit is actually that kind of fit in which you think that what strategies you are pursuing and you are in the future, you want to pursue those strategies. So whether the target company or the company who are merging within your organization, or with the in case of alliances, when you are making alliances with those organizations or the firms, whether they are fitting into your strategy or not, or they can also pursue your strategy in the future. So you have to see the strategic fit when you are making merger and acquisition and alliances, and in similar kind of organization, obviously you are in a position to find a strategic fit. Then a second thing is organizational fit, because when you are there are different organizations or different type of people or different type of culture or different type of geographical areas, different type of markets are merging with each other, or may alliances are there within these kind of firms. So you see that whether these organizations are fit into each other or not, whether after the merger or after the merger acquisition activity or after the alliances or the contracts, whether those people or those people working in the organization can say that accept those transition, accept the change when whether there is a cultural change or not. So you have to see all these things. The third thing is evaluation, because you when you want your merger and acquisition activity to be successful, it's very important that you should value very very carefully. You have should value synergy. You should value control benefits, you should value diversification benefit. Everything should be valued very properly, then you are in a position to make those transactions successful. On the other hand, when you are merging or you are making acquiring any firm which are different type of businesses, so in this case you'll go for a hostile option. Like in this case, you acquire that firm and you think that this hostile option would be beneficial, and when you are taking hostile option or you are opting for a hostile option, you are taking the shares or you are acquiring the shareholders, but you obviously your management is not with you. So in this case you have to see all the necessary option. After that you have to see the integrations. Integration means that how different businesses and how different type of businesses will integrate after the merger. So because they are in different line of businesses, and when they are in different line of businesses, obviously they are pursuing different type of strategies. They have different type of other activities. So how you will integrate all those activities, and the careful attention would be required in this type of integration. Then another thing is divestitures. Divestitures actually is the case in which you can close down all those bleeding units which you think that are not beneficial, and you'll go on follow a concentric strategy in which you will take all your finances into your beneficial units. So you can do this in that. But in the case of alliances, you will see go for courtship. Like courtship means that you will see that whether you are making alliance with certain people or certain businesses, whether it would be a good long-term relationship or not, or you can see that whether you will it would be beneficial for you or not, or whether both type of firm pursue the same common strategy, whether they have same type of temperament. So all these things have to be taken into consideration. Then the second is co-evaluation. You have to evaluate all those things which are very much important. You can go through all the necessary options. You can go through different type of strategies. You can see that whether these alliances would be beneficial in the future, whether these alliances will give you a benefit or not, and all those things related to that when you are actually evaluating each firm. Then another thing is termination, and we have already discussed this termination in the evaluation process. Like when you are terminating, because termination doesn't mean that you are ending up your relationship. In certain time, this termination can lead to new relationship, or certain time there would be a friendly termination. So this termination would be done very properly, because in the future it might be possible that you want to work in the future, or you want to have certain type of relationship in the future. So all these things are very much important, and these are actually the key success factors in merger and acquisition and alliances.